The incredible success of this trilogy created a deluge of Back to the Future merchandise. We're talking toys, games, fast food restaurant tie-ins, you name it. And I had all of it. If I'm being honest, I still have it. Back then, it seemed like everyone was collecting Back to the Future stuff. But for some collectors, memorabilia just wasn't enough. They wanted to own a piece of the movie. And no one has amassed a collection of authentic screen-used props quite like the father and son collecting team of Bill and Patrick Shea. Their fanaticism knows no bounds. Keeping a hawk's eye on auction houses all over the world, Bill and Patrick swoop in anytime an authentic Back to the Future prop emerges. They display their priceless collection by appointment only on their farm in rural Massachusetts. And I can't wait to hit the road and see what they've got. Speaking of which, Bill left us a message saying we could skip the car rental. He left us a very special surprise in parking lot C. Your 49 Packard. Okay, this is one of those out-of-body experiences. 35 years ago, Chris here was in this seat driving this exact car in Back to the Future. The DeLorean gets all the attention, but some of the most pivotal stuff in the movie happens in this car.
That's right.
I mean, this is where Marty's making out with his mom.
What I do in those situations?
What?
I don't worry.
This is where George knocks out Biff, right?
Get
your damn hands off her.
Get your damn hands off.
Oh. That's right here.
The fresh, crisp Massachusetts air.
You know I'm from Massachusetts.
How would I know that?
I don't know, maybe you Wikipedia'd me?
Huh? I'm good.
I'm very intrigued as to what this guy Bill Shea is all about. I mean, we've heard he's got three DeLoreans. Obviously, he's got your Packard, living out in the middle of the woods with a massive Back to the Future collection. Let's see here. I think, so this is supposed to be it. This is the address.
You think this is it?
Yeah, pretty sure this is it.
Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Okay, you ready to go?
Yeah, yeah, I'm a little scared.
Yeah, just stay close.
Okay.
Christopher Lloyd, as I live and breathe.
Wow.
And Josh, before we go in, I just got to tell you, I am a huge fan.
Oh, thanks. Tell Chris. He doesn't know who I am.
He doesn't know. This is Josh Gates. He's done a few TV shows.
Now, Bill and Patrick, who obviously have impeccable taste, know that we're here to see their DeLoreans. But we couldn't come all this way and not see the rest of their incredible collection. So can we see what's in the barns?
Let's do it.
Let's do it. Come on, lead the way.
All right.
For a Back to the Future fan like myself, this is once in a lifetime. Oh, my word.
Welcome to BTTF Nirvana.
Are you kidding me? Look at all this stuff. Look at all of this. I cannot believe my eyes right now. The last time I saw that van, I was sitting in the theater and watching it drive into a photo map. Now, Chris, this is probably very traumatic for you seeing this, right?
Yeah.
I mean, this poor guy pumped you full of lead.
No!
Let's not talk about it.
Okay, this is Mecca for Back to the Future fans. I am geeking out. I mean, the Hollywood Museum was great, but these guys, they've got everything, including the shirt that Doc Brown wore in all three Back to the Future films. Now, that's a shirt that you should have held on to. If you wore that shirt today, you'd look like a hipster.
Really?
Yeah, as opposed to whatever this Hawaiian thing is.
Careful.
It's a very interesting story, future boy.
This collection is absolutely next level and puts my model DeLorean and Lego sets to shame. They've even got a hand-painted mural of the clock tower scene. But Bill, always the mega fan, had himself painted into it. And right here is the very truck that every kid wanted in their driveway, including me, Marty's Toyota. Two coats of wax.
Naturally, Biff did his job.
Yeah, for the big camping trip,
absolutely.
Right?
Absolutely, sleeping bags are already in the back.
how did you get this? Where did it go after the movie?
Part one, there was a truck just like this one that after the filming, they actually raffled the truck off. Somebody won the truck, somebody wrecked the truck. So part two and part three come around and they need another truck. That's where this truck comes in. They fixed it up, made it look just like the one from part one, and here it is.
This is all pretty surreal, don't you think? As is the backstory on this truck. After completing its run in Back to the Future, it was stolen twice and ended up being recovered in Mexico after a brief career hauling drugs across the border. True story. It eventually made its way into the hands of Bill and Patrick, who gave it a full frame-off restoration to get it back to its original screen-used condition. It wasn't enough for them that they'd found the vehicle that once upon a time was Marty's Toyota. No, they needed it to be that truck again. Finding the right parts for a truck built in the 80s was tough, not time machine tough, but still. It took them 11 months to complete the restoration, but would you expect anything less from these two? Talk about obsessed. And yes, I'm here to find a time machine, but right now, I have time warped straight back into my childhood. Can I just stay here for a few more minutes? Is that possible?
We have more to show you. Follow us.
Okay, sure.
John.
Yeah.
What are the chances this guy tries to add me to the collection?
Chris, you're in the collection.
No, me.
Oh, well, okay. If it gets too weird, let's establish a safe word.
That's a good idea.
What's your safe word?
The.
The isn't a safe word.
Welcome to our loft.
Get the hell out of here. Wait a minute.
Yes.
They're real?
Indeed.
These are the Panthers from the Clock Tower.
The two Panthers from the Clock Tower.
Can you believe it?
Yeah, this is nuts. I mean, I don't want to be repetitive, but it's nuts.
I mean, Chris, the last time you saw this panther, you were hanging off of it.
Yeah, they attached me to the clock somehow.
I have always wanted to know this. The clock tower is, it's a real building. It's on the Universal backlot,
right? That's right.
Were you really up there?
Yeah. Well, it's a facade.
Right.
With all kinds of carpentry and structure in the back.
But it's really high.
It's about four floors. Raised me up.
Oh, it took you up there.
To it. They attached me, and then it went away. So I'm just...
floating up there.
Sky high.
Wow.
Yay!
And then, of course, like a million other things.
Absolutely.
Show us the goods here.
Well, I'm going to start off by telling you about something that is one of a kind, and that is Doc's Brainwave Analyzer Helmet.
There it is, the actual helmet that Doc wore the first time Marty meets him in 1955.
Doc, I'm from the future. I came here in a time machine that you invented.
Do you know what this means?
I tried to build one myself using bicycle parts and an unwound slinky, but you know, it doesn't quite compare to the real thing sitting right in front of me, looking as perfect as it did on the silver screen.
Then we have the one and only absolutely extremely rare remote control that Doc uses for the first incident of time travel.
Is this the one I have?
Absolutely, Chris. This is the one you held when you sent Einstein back in time.
Wow.
Forward in time.
Absolutely.
Ha! Bill Shea slipping. I got one over on.
Absolutely, yeah.
It's the only victory I'm going to have today. I'm taking it.
That's one of a kind?
Absolutely. Would you like to see our latest and greatest exhibit? Come with us.
Of course.
What you see here is an absolutely accurate recreation of the very first scene from Part 1, Back to the Future.
Down to, like, envelopes and spoons and trash?
Absolutely.
Is the plutonium under the bed?
The plutonium is absolutely
the plutonium under the bed.
Yeah. Careful.
Yeah.
This is bananas.